So I was serious when I said I was a nervous wreck, and I realize now I'm the last in your Women in Tech speaker series, which makes complete sense. You got to the bottom of the barrel and said, we'll get somebody who is totally not in tech. Amazing to me listening to everybody talk about what you do. What the hell is a UX? I'm the only one who doesn't know, right? User experience. Well, why didn't you just say so? Okay, right. I can relate to that. User experience. So, because I really don't consider myself to be tech, and it is a frightening thing. You know, we fear what is unfamiliar, and we hate what we fear. So think about that. It applies to people as well. As techy as I get, is this? You can't see it. It's my Fitbit. And I realized that they finally come down to my level, and it only took me about 30 seconds to figure out how it worked. I said, this is for me. And it works for me. It tells me how much I slept and tells me how many steps I have. So if I start walking around the room, I got about 4,000 more steps to go for today. But sometimes with technology creeps into your life, I guess, even when you don't know it. A lot of people wondering how in the world I went from the dream job of a TV anchor woman to the nightmare field of organized law enforcement. Let's look at that for just a minute. First of all, being an anchor woman was not my dream job. My dream job was to be a reporter. That's what I always thought I wanted to do. Once I realized I didn't want to be an actress because people didn't like me rewriting their lines. And this was in high school. My parents were afraid I was going to be an actress. And I found that reality was much more interesting than fiction. Even Shakespeare I wanted to ad lib on. When I discovered broadcast news as something that someone like me, black girl like me, could do because I saw Gail Christian do it on television, I said, that's it. It combines reality with a little bit of performance. So that dream job did become what was most people who wanted most, especially women at that time in the 1970s, to be, you know, an anchor woman, you know, which just being a talking head didn't really appeal to me. I liked the reporting. I liked the storytelling of it. And as far as now, you know, everybody's a reporter, okay? The citizen journalist is here. Welcome to the main stage. And I mean that because I think you've shown media what really should be doing. The fact that they're still not doing it is neither here nor there, but you know, they've missed a lot of stories and certainly given us an incomplete narrative, which came about partly because of the 24-hour news cycle. There's just not enough in facts, so you got to have commentary. And you gotta have opinions, and you gotta have people acting crazy because it's all about the eyeballs, right? And then in law enforcement, a noble profession, except that right now, it is being judged by the worst of them, because even a small amount of unconstitutional policing, of actual hatred, bullying, whatever, is unacceptable. We hold it to a very high standard. There's a lot of scrutiny on law enforcement. There is a realization that the way that it's operated and been told to operate by authority and control, it doesn't work. There's a very difficult time recruiting into law enforcement. I've only been with the Chicago Police Department since June. We had a recruitment opportunity that opened up in November. That's where they opened the police exam. And I don't know if you remember, there was a time when years and years would go by where there was no police exam. It's still that way at the fire department. Everybody wants to be a fireman. Everybody loves the fireman. I don't think they've had a fire exam in about 7 years. But I could be wrong. Don't quote me on that. I know y'all into data. But the police exam last year opened up as well, right after the Laquan McDonald shooting. You could not get African Americans to think about taking the Chicago Police Department exam. Gary McCarthy could not be sent into a black church to recruit on behalf of the Chicago Police Department. Recruitment is a problem in law enforcement across the country. It is simply seen as something you don't want to be. And I understand. Because if you keep doing the same thing over and harder and more of it with more people and more equipment, and we are not any safer and violence is not down, and people don't like you, that's the definition of job dissatisfaction. People who got into law enforcement to make a difference, to be of service, to do something honorable, which I would argue is the vast majority, find themselves going into neighborhoods for service and being jeered and telling them, you know, and people say, what you gonna do, shoot me? Because all of the anecdotal things that people had said for so many years suddenly became believable thanks to the cell phone video. Didn't make it happen any more often. It just made us finally say, see, I told you that people were being treated like that. Maybe not where you live. So it's a real, real come to Jesus moment. But I would argue that since the vast majority are feeling that what they got into law enforcement for is not been attainable because of the way that they are told to do it through authority and control versus collaboration and power sharing, which is the direction that we're trying to turn in. As a reporter, you know, I reported a lot about law enforcement. You know, they're held to a certain standard. There's a lot of easy picking stories. TV news became at one point obsessed, I call it, with lists, right? So on the data bit, I blame David Letterman and those dang, you know, top 10 reasons. We had the 6 things you need to know before you go to bed, the 5 things you need to know before you college, before you go to college, the 10 things you need to know before you wake up. It was lists, lists, lists. And what we were trying to do, or so it appeared, was to use data to boil down complex issues into bite-sized pieces, when in fact what people needed was the full meal. You couldn't get it out of a list. We had decided that the audience's attention span was short. It had to be on fire or bleeding or screaming or a list. And I think we did everyone pretty much a disservice. My challenge was that I knew that there were things that people needed to know. I would often tell people, they say, oh, I watch you all the time. I say, well, I hope you're also getting the paper. Hope you're also reading some news magazines. I hope you're also getting your information from someplace else, because if you are just getting it from television news, you won't know anything. That's just to try to inspire you to maybe go find out some more. That's a terrible thing to tell somebody about your own industry, right? You say, I am not the full meal. You better go and get your information nourishment elsewhere. Of course, where I was sending them, they weren't doing so well either. Newspapers are thinner and thinner and thinner, and only those who have been able to make it online are probably going to make it in the end. But we knew from the data and from my interest in giving people the benefit of the doubt that they actually were interested and able to digest and might even be able to do something about complex challenges. And I started realizing that I was working every day to make my stories not be a minute and a half, not 2 minutes, not be just the symptom of something, but the root of something. And it wasn't easy. But because I'd been at one station for so many years and I had a little influence, I did do some work that I was pretty proud of. And what I started to see was that it was all connected. Everything that we thought were our ills and our challenges, there was not one thing. It was not just education, right? It was not just poverty, right? It was not just disparity. It was not just law enforcement. It was not just those ratchet politics. It was all connected. And so if you look at some of the work from my last few years at Fox, that's Fox Chicago, not the other Fox, you'll see a picture starting to emerge, and it won't be so surprising that I ended up where I am.
Standing on this corner in Roseland, we've been stopped 3 times by people asking, has something bad happened again? They don't get used to it. The people here pay the ultimate price, the victims, the family members. But there's also a dollar cost to the violence that we all pay.
I'm Robin Robinson. One of the alleged gunmen in the park shooting had gone through the program, which raised questions from a lot of people, including police, about just how effective it is.
The issues are very complex. The challenge is great. We've talked about all of this way too often before, the violence exploding across the part of the city where I am right now in the Inglewood neighborhood and on the west side and in Lawndale, particularly violent. The victims have ranged from young children to a 72-year-old woman. They don't have much faith in the idea that more policing is going to be the answer. They don't seem to have much faith in the police. They say it is not a police problem. It is a social problem, and that there needs to be jobs. There needs to be counseling. There needs to be something for these young people to do in the summertime. The University of Chicago professor who co-authored the best-selling book, Freakonomics, is a pretty smart guy. So he tackled revealed a tough question. Does locking more and more criminals up in prison actually lower crime? His research suggests that it does reduce crime. But even he says it's not the only solution, not even the best one. If it was, it probably would have worked by now. America has the highest number of people behind bars in the world and, adjusted for population, the highest incarceration rate. And experts say one of the best ways to keep Cook County Jail and prisons bursting at the seams is to send young people who get in trouble with the law to places like this, a juvenile detention center. Once a kid gets locked up, they enter a system that they often find it very hard to exit from. That's true despite major reforms here at this once notorious facility.
I'm in this atmosphere that I never thought I'd see myself in.
We have accused murderers. We have accused rapists.
You have to also look at the kids themselves as victims.
This is a place for no one to spend their time, not even a second.
This teenager has been in the detention center for a year awaiting trial on a murder charge. He says it's really hard being locked up, but he has learned something.
All these young adults are here. They have potential. They can give back to the community. They can give back to somebody else, even though they took something from someone or hurt someone.
That's just a little one. Yeah, that's a little potato.
Some get to see real fruits of unfamiliar labor, seeing what you get out from what you put in to a karma garden.
It look bad, but it's a lot going on up underneath.
Kind of like people.
Yeah.
Okay.
You never know what's going on inside.
What's going on inside these walls these days may not seem like law and order or corrections, but make no mistake, the tension is palpable. The rapid response team gets called on every day.
All the violence in Chicago, we get them here. We have kids come straight off the street or right out of court here with a lot of baggage, a lot of anger, so it can be at any point a dangerous situation at any point.
But the quality of staff that we have now is just night and day. I mean, it's not a guard inmate mentality at all. And, you know, if we are not already the best, we are one of the best detention centers that's out there.
But every success story here proves how badly we failed elsewhere.
But instead of, you know, having the funding of putting a kid in here for $600 a day, is to have a better use of money by trying to get those resources out in the community to better service the kids.
$600 a day. Imagine that being spent on education or intervention. Yet this seems to be what the public cries for when the streets run with blood.
You know, in recent times when there was the big push to kind of get hard on crime, we do see an increase in our population. I think we have to get to the bottom of why are more kids creating crimes and to be able to solve it at that level so that they don't hit a place like this or they don't hit the Cook County Jail.
So I'm sorry, I know there's only 15 minutes. That's a pretty long video, which is the issue with trying to report on complex issues, right? Is that you can't do it in a minute and a half or two. So do we have time to really get to the bottom of the problem? One thing we do like to do is to use the data to push the idea of the question, because what you question determines what you really care about. So the Cook County Detention Center, which was featured in that video, at one time, at its worst, had more than 800, they even called them inmates then, right? Young people, 800 young people. It was built for 450. There's 250 in there now. I was just there last month. They are now residents. They now are looking at a more restorative approach. There was a summit where they had what they call level four residents, which are young people who have reached a level of leadership, and they presented to a group of all, you know, powerful adults, state's attorneys and what have you, and talked about what they wish had happened in their life. How does that kind of change happen? Well, it happens because they got sued and they were under a consent decree to do it. So sometimes a little scrutiny is not a bad thing, right? Systems can change. It also happened because the data showed them what they were doing was just creating from the baby prison to the big prison, feeding a beast. I remember the first time someone told me, is my time up? The lights are going off. Someone told me, mentioned the word, and it's about 20 years ago, disproportionate minority contact. I was actually at the detention center, and a young prosecutor, a young black woman, handed me a manila envelope almost surreptitiously. I'm like, what the hell? Is it a bomb? What is it? She says, read this. And I read it. And it was, you know, I guess obviously data wasn't coming online, but I don't think we even had email back then, right? So it might have been more than 20 years ago. Wow, I'm old. But she handed it to me. Her name was Kathy Bankhead. And I started reading it, and it was difficult. It was thick to get through, right? But she was seeing all these cases, and they were all black and brown. And she had, you know, she said, and she'd been reading a disproportionate minority contact. So I got to the station. After I read it, I said, you know, we should do this story. Everybody's eyes glazed over. What is this? Just a bunch of statistics, you know, what are we going to do with that? Now, of course, everyone understands disproportionate minority contact and what it has created. And so it has driven some change. We understand that, but it depends on who you are, how you receive that information, right? So the one thing I didn't mention in that story, you saw all the young people that we could see their hands and their feet and what have you in the juvenile detention center. Who are they? Who are they? They're black. Okay, we're afraid to even say it. They're 80% black. So as a reporter, when I do who, what, when, where, and I want to do why so bad, we can't do why if we can't even do who. If we're afraid of who we're talking about. And the fear comes on both sides. African Americans don't necessarily want to dwell on that because that kind of resurrects the old, you know, 500-year-old black beast. You know, it gives people, some people, what I call psychosclerosis, a hardening of the attitudes. That just says, you know, well, that's how they are. And then white people don't want to get the burden of the history of enslavement and kidnap and torture and, you know, inhumanity for 350 years. And, you know, if there's some sort of blame or guilt, if we can't talk about it, we can't get past it. And if we don't recognize it as the root of the problem, we will never get past it. Last night I was watching a news show that I really like, a reporter that I really like. I think they're good. She did a 6-minute piece on something called the Opportunity Youth. Anybody familiar with that? There's 58,000, this according to the University of Chicago Urban Lab, 58,000 youth who are not in school, not employed, they're just hustling. And to connect them with opportunities, right? And to use the data of what kind of opportunities would be appropriate for them. And she did this long story. It was great. It was really in depth. One time, while talking about something that the data had produced from the crime lab, one time, there was one sentence that said youth of color. But every young person that was shown in this story was African American. So maybe the assumption is we already know that. I don't think that's what it is. I think we just don't like to talk about that. So I'm tired of talking just about symptoms. And I did the same thing in my report, right? I just kind of glossed over it. We cannot gloss over it any longer. And in law enforcement, it is particularly sensitive. People have got a lot more knowledge today. They know what the origins of organized law enforcement are. They know that it comes from slave catchers, all right? Young African-American activists know this. There are people who are advocating for police abolition. People are feeling some kind of way. And the only way, I think, to bridge that divide is to actually bring people together as human beings. Because the two groups that are suffering most from this, not only are 80% of the youth in the detention center African-American, but you've heard of the strategic subject list, right? That's the department's big tech and data accomplishment, which is based on information put in that they always tell me has nothing to do with geography or race, but just what your contact with law enforcement has been, how many times you've been arrested, how many times you've been shot, et cetera, et cetera. You are on a list of someone who is very likely in the immediate future to either perpetrate or be the victim of a crime. That list shares the same demographics that we're talking about, right? So there's a picture that gets in your head, and you've decided that just as you will see, if you see a viral video over and over again of, you know, Laquan McDonald being shot 16 times, of other, we've got videos of, you know, police officers engaged in what apparently, and in many cases, blatantly, you know, horrific behavior. So they are both judged by the worst of them. So you, if you were really honest, you would admit that if you see a young black man with a certain kind of a uniform on, dreads, tats, low pants, you get a little scared, don't you? You see a police officer after watching all those viral videos, and if you happen to be that young black man and see a police officer, you are doing everything you can to go the other way. So it's a stereotyping that both have in common. So to bring them together, to see that at the end of the day, we're all really much more alike than we are different. We just have a different condition. I want people to treat each other like they would want their son, daughter, mother, father, sister, brother, uncle treated, and that's on both sides. And when they get together for long enough in a not emergency situation, That's what happens. I have no idea what to do with this now, right? So I know there's a PowerPoint here somewhere, but right now I see Stevie Wonder and okay.
Just watch.
We could do that. That would work for me. Using the Chicago Community Trust on the table model of bringing people together over food, something about food that's kind of magical, we've incorporated it into the department's Bridging the Divide initiative, which was already going on when I got there. This is not something I created in my little 8 months there, right? It was already going on a small scale. And expanding that to not just these little fun events, okay, you were nice while we were at this baseball game, or you were nice for a few minutes, but to a real relationship-building cohort, so that you spend 10 to 12 weeks with the same group of officers and the same group of young people. And not officers from CAPS, officers from the watch, officers that might actually show up on your block, right, or might come if you call 911, and trying to have as diverse a group of officers as possible. So on the table is for anyone in the community that's just getting together for a meal on a regular basis with officers, and then Bridging the Divide is something we do specifically with young people. So this is a place called the Peace House in Englewood, and they are on the table with officers from the 7th District. And this, you see that she did try to get all the officers to wear that button, but they wouldn't all do it. We've had large and small gatherings. We do things called, I'm sure you guys are familiar with community cafes, kind of harvesting the wisdom of the people that are there. This is the 7th District again. And I can tell you that this young woman, this man here, the other guy's not in the pictures, had never spoken to a police officer in anything except a moment of conflict in their entire life. So people are getting together in police districts all around the city. We do use restorative practices. You can't sometimes, when you really get into the deep conversations, it's not like you can just start talking. So we do use peace circle, sharing circle, whatever it might be, conflict circle, depending on where you are. And we do that with a lot of fidelity. We really adhere to the principles of kind of an ancient problem-solving method. We try to engage young people who consider the police to be the opposition with the police. This was actually where I first met the team that's been doing Bridging the Divide. It was before I joined the department, and I was just trying to do a little research, and I went to a symposium on 21st century policing at Northwestern Law School, and they had these officers who were working in Bridging the Divide come in and do circles with the students. And this is where we have the police. The superintendent often talks about having recruits who may have never spent a minute with a black person, depending on where they're from, while they're still recruits, to actually engage with young people at high schools. So they do play basketball. However, we never just play. We always have conversation as well. So this is before a Cease for Peace basketball league that they had in Lawndale. And these are the circles they do before the game. They say, we actually get on the court. Everybody has to leave the gym. You know, there's no observers in circle. And this is the last day of it where we actually had the superintendent come out. We actually had a young man say to us after it was a series of four in this tournament. He said, you know, I can play basketball anytime. I want more of that conversation. So since perception sometimes is half the battle, and that whole Chirac moniker stuck to us, there's an artist in Bronzeville by the name of Messiah Equiano who came up with the term Chi-Rise instead of Chirac, which is basically, as one goes, we all go. And if we're going to rise, we all have to do it together. And I love the concept. And plus, with the stars on it, made it look like, you know, almost a government or a law enforcement initiative, though it's not. It applies to anything that improves anyone's situation in the city, right? And the idea that we're all in it, not just those who face every day the results of us not rising. So I came up with a way to, I asked districts, find me officers who don't do the usual brave thing, right? Save the kids, save the cat. You know, I want the officers who are brave enough to be vulnerable to community, to partner with them on projects, to also, you know, have a conversation with them, give them voice, hear, reconcile with how people are feeling, and also let them know how you're feeling. That was a little bit hard for the people in the districts. They said, you want what? I said, you know, but they did finally come up with some folks, and we honored them at the Cub Sox. So with the officer and the community member that they were partnering with got to come to the game. We made T-shirts and gave them all out. So it's, and then there's these little block parties. The community trusts actually funded people on the ground instead of at the treetops for that Labor Day initiative last year. And we made sure that officers were as involved in that as possible, just out talking to people. This is more, this young man here is now he is now an official applicant to the Chicago Police Department, which no one could be more shocked than his family. That's kind of, you know, what we do. And there we are, that's one. And I want you to know that we don't just talk. So there is a connecting people with people they wouldn't otherwise be with, right? This gentleman here, his name is Reynolds Wintersmith. He spent 19 years in jail because he had life plus 40 years. Because it was a three strikes, you're out kind of thing on a drug conspiracy. Nothing violent, drug conspiracy. He grew up in Rockford. He was 19 years old when he was sentenced to life plus 40 years. His sentence was commuted by the president about 4 years ago. He used his time. He was always a smart guy, smart kid. He was a businessman. He wasn't violent. His grandmother was a dope dealer, all right? So he became a dope dealer. But the fact that that's the potential we locked up, right? Because we couldn't figure out why he would, we just had to stop him. We had to stop him. That was the answer, was to incarcerate people. People on a hustle because there's nothing else to be on. So he cannot work in a public school with a felony background, but he can work at an options school. So where young people go to try to, restart their high school career, usually after a bout with engaged in the criminal justice system. They've been arrested. And so it's CCA Academy on the west side, and he started working there. He quickly became the most popular counselor there because he can relate to these young people. So we had a on the table with them and their students, and this at our third one, we decided we were going to work on what can we do, not just talk. So we teamed up. What do you want to do, and who in this room can help you do it? Officers and community members and young people. And we have, as a result of that, there's a chess club that goes on every Wednesday morning at that school with officers and the young people who proposed it. And young people who didn't think they want to be part of it are coming by saying they sure like they're having fun. You know, there's something about doing something with someone where you don't necessarily have to look them in the eye, you're looking at the board. You know, you might be revealing something, you know, because you're not looking at them. There's a real connection that happens there. And then after that day, when they said they proposed, the young person wanted to do a chess club. He says, everybody's not an athlete, I don't want to play basketball. So we were leaving there thinking, that'd be great. That's an easy lift. We can make that happen. And that's at a district level. I don't make it happen, right? There's 22 police districts. So the officers in that police district, partnering with the young people at that school, made that happen. And we were leaving there, and we were driving on Roosevelt Road, and I saw this on the street. I found out later that there's a place called the Firehouse, which also serves young people. And because they had heard about and liked the Shy Rise idea, they, as their own project, without telling us, because like I said, it's not a police thing, this is an idea for the city, they had painted this mural on a corner. And I thought, well, that's a great day's work. And there's validation right there that positive concepts can also catch on. So I would argue that since I envision would like to have a world where when my son walks out the door, I only have to worry about the usual stuff. The fast cars, the fast girls, you know, the full beer. That I don't have to worry about any extra stuff. I don't want to worry about the world looking at him fearfully, treating him any other way. You know, he's already at the age of crazy. No need to add anything to it. But as a young black man, I know that there's things out there that can trip him up that are extra that I have to worry about. I don't want to have to worry about that. I also don't want to have to worry about people who are cops being ops. I want them to be partners and peacekeepers within communities that they collaborate with. So I would say that since I no longer have to just talk about the problems, I get to try to do something about it, that I'm actually in my dream job right now. And I welcome any of you to join me on this journey. It's all about building relationships, and I'm sure that you've got some sort of app that can help me get people together. So thanks for having me.
I was wondering if you do any work on police accountability, and if so, what are your feelings about CPAC, the proposal for the civilian-led police accountability council?
COPA, or CPAC is the one they didn't
adopt. CPAC is a different proposal, yes.
My feeling is that we make plans for those few, just like we do rules at work or rules at home, right? Which makes the rest of paints everybody else the same way. And I think that you, no matter who does something wrong, that everyone has to be accountable. And as soon as you can change the culture within an organization, especially something like policing, where people are bound with this kind of, you know, we could die out here and you could be the one to keep that from happening to me as my partner, even if I don't like you or don't like what you do. So we have to create a framework where the culture has shifted to what you're doing is wrong and you're making me unsafe because you're making people hate me, right? Because cops don't tell on cops because they're afraid. Don't tell them I told you, right? Because saying you're afraid is not something people do in law enforcement, right? But if you really think about it, you should be more afraid of what happens because of the wrong that your brethren do that makes people hate you and makes you lose your legitimacy. In terms of a process, a structure, a bureaucracy that fairly and objectively handles the complaints, the wrongdoing, you know, I think that it's just like anything else. It's only going to be as good as the people that you need to have to keep their own legitimacy. You know, you have to start with a different kind of internal culture. So they could arrange it any way they want. In my opinion, people will find a way around it. What do you think? Did you like CPAC better than COPA?
Yeah, I think that COPA, the people on COPA, mm-hmm. kind of have their own private interests that aren't in the interest of the community.
And CPAC, CPAC was elected at every...
CPAC would be civilian elected, so it would be the people of Chicago. But anyway, right. I don't want to...
But that's okay. I love these conversations because, I mean, there is also the idea that I think there needs to... You need civilian oversight, right? You don't want... you know, it's already a paramilitary organization, right? But it's of the people. So you don't... I think that's a good idea. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
Uh-oh, I'm pointing people out, and I have no mic.
I just wondered, you said how great it is that Chai Rise now is spreading, just like bad things can spread, good things.
Not quite as far as Chirac, I'm not
sure. Yeah, I know, that was quite far.
Bad news has its own wings.
But do you feel like things are starting to reach a tipping point, or... It seems like it's always hard at the start when you don't have that momentum. And I wondered if it makes it harder for your job and if you feel like you have reached a point, like for the officers or for the communities or both.
So when I see, I've reached that point with many individuals. It's very hard to stand back and see when have you reached it systemically, right? But I have seen people make a connection who thought they couldn't. I've seen a 19-year veteran officer cry in a peace circle because he got on the job to make things better, and not only they're not better, they're worse, and people don't like him. I've seen transformation, right? Whether it's at a tipping point in terms of our image, which I hate to tell you is not really my concern, it's the reality that I'm concerned with, but the image is what's gotten people's attention, right?
The buy-in to the...
Well, you know, I think there is a buy-in to the fact that what we've been doing isn't working. So unless you're going to be with a certain, how do I put this? I hate to mention the name, a certain political culture that says, you know, just comply and, you know, lock them up and get tough, you know, the psychosclerosis. Then you have to realize that the definition of insanity is to just keep doing what we've been doing, but do more of it, and that will be the answer. But what worries me is that the numbers had to get unacceptable. What is an acceptable number? You know, I guess if it's not you or yours, anything that's not you or yours, right? So if it goes down, if the violence goes down a little bit, will we stop? Will people stop worrying about it, caring about it, doing things about it? Will the initiative stop? Will those who are comfortable, you know, be lulled into a sense of, well, it's okay, it's just a few people who don't know how to act, as opposed to an entire swath of our community that have been completely, had every opportunity for mobility to move up, to do better, stripped away systemically for, and I know y'all hate to hear this, 500 years. Okay, so, but that is what it is.
Well, thank you. I appreciate you. And I just want to ask, are there plans to expand the Bridge and Divide on the Table program? And if so, does that include more traditional forms of community police interaction like beat meetings and CAPS officers?
So beat meetings and CAPS officers. So what's happened with CAPS is that within the department, it's like, well, those are the CAPS officers and those are the real police, right? The police look at each other that way, right? So the CAPS officers get to have all the fun. And you realize that CAPS never stood for community policing. Anybody know what CAPS stood for? One of the most famous? Yes, sir. That's right. Alternative being the key word, right? It's not an alternative. It is the only way. Okay, so if every officer, if you can't police with community, if you can't recognize that you are part of community, and that you can't just tell people what to do and resolve everything, people have to be led to lead themselves and learn to co-create peace and safety. Because you cannot go in and I can't whoop safety on you, all right? It has to be collaborative. And so there are officers who are not CAPS officers, and frankly, there are CAPS officers who have had no particular training about how to collaborate with community, how to give people a voice in the solutions that they need to co-create. You know, we teach them how to do everything else. We have to, if you tell an officer, go out and engage the community, they do the what? What does that mean? What does it mean exactly to you? Should I smile at people, shake hands, walk into business? What does that mean? What is effective so-called engagement? I think that as a civilization, we are just learning what that is, because usually we're just informing people of stuff. Right? It's not a two-way street, but I'm loving what I'm seeing in places. That's where I met Kyla, was at the social lab, right? This shows how to really give people a role and a voice and power in the things that you're working on. Because we can't do things for people, we have to do them with people. So CAPS is under review right now. Beat meetings and CAPS, so they were considered like this amazingly, you know, innovative and groundbreaking thing in the 90s when it came about. And, you know, everybody does remember why community policing was even becoming a thing, right? Because of Rodney King. So the federal government gave all this money to the local police departments. You guys, you need to do something. Community policing. But community policing really involves power sharing. So we didn't at that time. It was Old Man Daly. Not Old Man Daly, I'm sorry. I get the Dalys mixed up. Young Man Daly, who's now getting up there. We want some of that federal money, but we don't really want community policing exactly. So they created CAPS. While it had the federal money, it was gangbusters. Beat meetings have become where people just come and tell police their problems and tell them to solve them, right? And now that there is no resources, the police say, call 311. Why would you go to a beat meeting, right? So it should be a meeting where everybody talks about what the solutions are, because they are not always law enforcement solutions. You know, so you have to somehow get together. And on the table is not just about working things out with police and community members, it's among community members as well, because somebody's calling the police. Who's calling the police on those young people, right? They're not doing anything yet, but I know they're up to something, and then, you know, you better get over here. And then the police get over there, well, what am I supposed to do? They're hanging out, you know, looking like they might be up to something, but so getting that person that calls together with those young people they're calling on, and there's a whole mix of people that need to be gotten together. So CAPS is there's a CAPS panel, advisory panel, that has been convened. They originally said that they were going to have a report in the first quarter, and they were convened in like December. And I thought, oh, so just 3 months, you're going to fix the whole thing in 3 months. Well, fortunately, they recognized that the deeper work was required, and there are actually 3 community meetings in the next 6 weeks to try to get more feedback. They've been collecting feedback online. And then probably in June, they'll have some recommendations. What the superintendent says is that every officer has to have some CAPS. Every officer needs to have some. You got to have some new skills. You know, you can't just, you know force mitigation, how to shoot your gun, you know, how to control the situation. You have to have some new skills. There's a big debate, you know, as I said, we were doing this recruitment this year, which did go better than last year, by the way. We got about 14,000 recruits, and we had a good a good turnout of African-American recruits. Hispanic recruits actually have been doing well all along. They kind of recognize it as a great job and career opportunity, which it is. Let me take a minute to promote. You know, within 18 months, you're making $72,000 a year with great benefits, full tuition reimbursement. I've never met so many people with master's degrees and PhDs in an organization in my life because it's full tuition reimbursement. But, you know, back in the day, it was 40,000 people that were signing up to take the police exam. 40,000 people. We're happy to have gotten 14. Right? If we had 40,000, there's nothing, you know. But that gave you a pool of people to really get the best from. So in some neighborhoods, in some areas, people were like, I wouldn't be the police. I had the opportunity to be a hacker, okay? In other neighborhoods, I wouldn't be the police. I hate you guys. So you're kind of caught between that rock and a hard place. But that said, we require 60 hours of post-high school credits. And some people have said, well, that's a barrier. You know, you need to get rid of that. Why can't a high school graduate? And we're trying to get better and more like a profession, not go the other, which is not to say that there are some really smart people that you know, didn't go to college. So just go get those 60 credit hours, right? In the UK, they're now requiring you to have a bachelor's degree. It needs to be a profession and not just a job, because it's really important. But how to attract people to it, I think once there's some success and the honor of it is not overshadowed by the attempts, oftentimes failed attempts, to transform the way that it deals with the dishonor that exists within it. I probably didn't answer your question, so I don't know about the BEAT meeting, but okay. I ran out of time. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I think it's about all the time we have for. Thank you, Robin.
Oh, that was not very techy, was it?
It's great.